Tonight on Dispatches, dramatic new evidence on one of the country's most puzzling unsolved murders. Who killed policewoman Yvonne Fletcher in London's St. James's Square? Last week, Dispatches demonstrated why the official version of events, that she was shot from the Libyan embassy, could not be true. Now, to conclude this major two-part investigation, Dispatches reveals just who plotted her murder and why. Tonight, reporter Joe Layburn travels to Berlin. In this German underworld, he finds the man who knows how she was killed, and the man who brought the gun into Britain. His report raises the most profound concerns about the intelligence services in Britain and America. And tonight, Dispatches joined Yvonne's mother in calling for a full inquiry into murder in St. James's.
St. James's Square in London's West End, neat and classical, the very spirit of Englishness. But there are dark secrets here. 13 years ago, a young policewoman was gunned down during a routine demonstration. At the time, the world's media believed she'd been shot by a Libyan diplomat. But nothing was as it seemed that day.
I think the government, the intelligence agencies got together and decided that there was a bigger picture.
Tonight, after a two-year investigation, Dispatches unravels a sinister international plot involving ruthless armed gangsters from the Berlin underworld and a shadowy terrorist group supported by the Reagan White House. Tonight, Dispatches reveals what had previously been unthinkable, that members of the British and American intelligence services connived in a plot which led to the murder of a British police officer, a fatal sideshow in their secret war against Colonel Gaddafi.
There's still a lot of questions to be answered, and somebody knows something somewhere along the line. What did happen?
But despite a campaign which culminated in the bombing of Tripoli and heavy civilian casualties, the maverick Gaddafi is still in place. Yvonne Fletcher and many others are dead. So far, despite overwhelming evidence, the authorities have refused to ask the right questions about this case, for fear, it seems, of the answers they might find. The official version of events, which the authorities still hold to, is that she died after two Sterling submachine guns were fired from the first floor of the Libyan embassy at number 5, St. James's Square. But from the start, the official line began to unravel. The post-mortem report of Home Office pathologist Dr. Ian West was quite clear. She'd been shot at an angle of 60 to 70 degrees from the upper floors of an adjacent building.
You're talking 6, 7, 8 floors, depending on how far away from the building the subject is standing.
But when forensic experts searched the embassy, they only found traces of gunpowder on the first floor, an angle of just 15 degrees. Come the inquest, Dr. West changed his analysis drastically. He claimed that WPC Fletcher must have been turning, since this would greatly reduce the angle of the bullet wound.
The fact is that if you turn, the lumbar spine still remains in roughly the same area. It's a nonsense.
This graphic shows just how far Yvonne Fletcher would have had to lean back to get the angle down to 15 degrees. It's impossible. In any case, witnesses agree that she was upright when she was shot.
Do you think Yvonne Fletcher was shot from number 5, from the building behind you?
I would think it's almost impossible that she was shot from number 5, because there's no floor in the building which would give an angle of 60 to 70 degrees or anything close to it.
And there are other inconsistencies. The bullet which killed Yvonne Fletcher was running out of energy when it hit her. Her injuries show it was tumbling as it passed through her. But a bullet from a Sterling submachine gun would not start tumbling until it neared the end of its range, greater than the width of the square. Yvonne Fletcher was standing just 30 yards away.
I don't think a submachine gun killed a police lady.
Why not?
Because the bullet was going comparatively slowly.
And at 30 yards, you'd expect the bullet to go almost straight through anybody standing in front of it.
This tape, recorded by a student demonstrator, destroys the official line of two submachine guns, but police withheld it from the inquest. It captures a single burst of 11 shots, but the police recovered 12 bullets. We found the audio signature of the 12th bullet on a tape recorded by one of the TV crews. They switched on late and only caught a separate, isolated shot.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We've got 11 bullets from the automatic weapon and we seem to have the 12th. There is something at this point. Now, whether that sounds like a shot, a single shot, that is.
The cameraman is turning over for 2.5 seconds before he picks up that loud bang.
Yes.
Can these two be related?
No, they're not related at all. No. This is a separate shot entirely.
So what does that tell you? Does it suggest that there is another weapon involved here?
It suggests that there's another weapon. It suggests that there is either a handgun or something, another gun.
Firing a single shot.
Firing a single shot.
One building is tall enough to match the steep angle of the bullet wound, number 3. At the time, the whole 6th floor was vacant, though it was used by the British security services for surveillance.
The explanation I was given for the people that did ask if they could view the square from the 6th floor area was that there was a lot of pilfering going on in the square and they wanted to try and view different parts of the square from that angle.
But you don't really buy that explanation. You think they were more interested
not
in the
now.
Libyans?
Not now. I did at the time.
The evidence points to one disturbing conclusion. Yvonne Fletcher was shot by a second gunman from a different building who was able to use the gunfire from the embassy as cover. But who was he? And who set him up to do it? It's now clear that her murder was part of a much bigger picture. The two groups of Libyans who taunted each other that day represented a wider, ongoing battle. For Gaddafi's efforts to eradicate his exiled dissidents did not go unanswered. From early 1984, Libyan diplomats in Europe started fearing for their own lives after a series of tit-for-tat assassinations by a sinister terrorist group called Al-Burkan. The truth behind the murder in St. James's Square is to be found in surprising places, like the seedy underworld of Berlin, where sex, drugs and guns are the currency of nightly life. There are ruthless men here who know well the name of Yvonne Fletcher. What's more, they know exactly how and why she died.
While Gaddafi's hit squads made the headlines for hunting down Libyan dissidents, another private army was at work. In the 80s, criminals from Berlin's underworld knew plenty about Libyan politics. That's because they were the hired hands behind a killing spree of Gaddafi supporters. Their paymasters, rich Libyan exiles, pledged to end Gaddafi's rule. There's compelling evidence that the gun which killed Yvonne Fletcher came from here, just one of many shipped from Berlin all over Europe.
We've tracked down some of the main players who helped Gaddafi's enemies in their bid to usurp him. Many of them fear for their safety now and refuse to talk on camera. Others see their participation in this film as a form of life insurance. The anti-Gaddafi Libyans used them in part as gun runners, supplying weapons for assassinations. Their leader was this man, Hilmar Hein. The silencers were fashioned by one of his closest henchmen, Helmut Nagler.
So tell me about these weapons that you remodeled.
I took in parts to see how it works, no? And it was very easy to manufacture such a silencer because it's no big secret, no? how it works.
And who were these weapons for?
Yeah, Hein told me these weapons were for good friends for self-protection.
Why do you need silencers for self-protection?
Yes, that's right. And now I know this pistol were for this Burkan organization in London.
For the anti-Gaddafi Libyans?
Yeah, for the anti-Gaddafi Libyans.
Nagler worked closely with this man, Manfred Meyer. The gang's exploits took in a firebomb attack on Libya's embassy in Bonn, but always their stock in trade was guns.
Also überwiegend waren das Urweiler PDK. Da war noch Beretta. Da hing ja, die Waffen hingen ja kreuz und quer. Da hat der, habe ich selber nicht mal durchgeblickt, wo, was, welche Waffen hinkamen und so. Aber überwiegend Walter PDK.
Und waren 9mm Pistolen auch dabei?
Wir hatten noch 9mm. Die Schalldämpfer waren quasi Messingröhren, da kamen Leder- und Aluminiumscheiben immer rein, die wurden dann justiert für das eigentliche Projektil und unten kam dann ein gedrehtes Metall rein mit Innengewinde und das wurde dann da aufgeschraubt. Die Dinger haben wunderbar funktioniert.
The man paying for their deadly work, Hilmar Hein, was in public the boss of a prominent Berlin construction company. In private, he helped run a terrorist organization. Not for ideological reasons, but for profit.
Well, I would say he is megalomaniac, selfish, greedy, trying to prevail in every situation.
Is he dangerous?
Very dangerous. His honesty and credibility is not worth a rush. He brings the people in a certain dependence to him. When he is promising things he never kept, he's a coward, delegating rubbish work to these stooges to keep his own hands clean.
Ich meine, Hein war reich zu diesem Zeitpunkt, sehr reich, ja. Der wusste selber nicht, wie viele Millionen er hatte. Aber es ging um die Macht. Er wollte die Welt verbessern. Ja.
Hein first came into contact with wealthy opponents of the Gaddafi regime through business dealings with this man, Rajeb Zatut. An internal document from the German police said he should be seen as a leading member of the anti-Gaddafi terrorist group Al-Burkan. Al-Burkan, which means the volcano, claimed responsibility for a number of fatal attacks on Libyan diplomats. Many of the murder weapons were traced back to Berlin.
They would kill these two people, one in Vienna and one in Rome. Libyan diplomats, and the weapons for this killing came from Hein, or he has organized this for this anti-Gaddafi group.
For Al-Burkan?
For Al-Burkan.
Und was für Leute sind Al-Burkan? Sind sie zu fürchten?
Wenn ich so rechne, wir hatten uns 12, 13 Tote an, ich weiß nicht, ob das zu fürchten ist, aber zu unterschätzen sind sie nicht. Fürchten, fürchten. Tod ist tot, ja.
But always at the top of the agenda was the ultimate prize, Colonel Gaddafi. In early 1984, another colonel, Oliver North, also had Gaddafi in his sights. As part of President Reagan's unofficial foreign policy, North planned for teams of foreign nationals backed by the CIA to neutralize terrorists opposed to America. Al-Burkan enjoyed just such CIA support. Significantly, Hilmar Hein claims to have met Colonel North in Bangkok during Easter 1983.
Al-Burkan commissioned Hein to organize weapons, even groups and an organization to kill Gaddafi.
They actually wanted to kill Gaddafi? Yeah. And who put the money up for that?
This money came from the organization in $30 million.
Sollte der CIA an Hein, also an Satu, 100 Millionen quasi, umgerechnet 100 Millionen Mark, aufgerufen haben, diese zur Unterstützung hatten.
Und das können Sie mit Sicherheit sagen?
Ja, das hat mir ja Hein selber gesagt.
One plan they floated was to recruit mercenaries through contacts in Marseille and get them into Libya posing as workers for Hein's scaffolding company. But despite the huge bounty, the Germans called it off as a suicide mission. Al-Burkan, meanwhile, wanted a training center for their guerrillas. Hein found them this building on a Berlin industrial estate. Other Al-Burkan forces were trained in the USA.
Geplant war ja, dass hier quasi im Keller die Terroristen oder dann die Leute, die dann die Söldner, die dann in Tripolis den eigentlichen Sturz oder den Putsch damit unterstützen sollten, dass sie hier ausgebildet werden sollten. Und da hatte ich dann hier einen Schießplatz, einen Schießstand eingerichtet.
Hier in diesem Gebäude?
Ja, hier drinnen, ja. Hier kommt man rein und dann links unten ist der Keller. Aber ein richtig großer Industriekeller. Ja.
Number 32 Klicksstraße, one of Hein's workshops in West Berlin. It was here that they took apart a distinctive gold-colored Mercedes, number plate BNY604. Three guns were secreted in the sump. Together with handmade silencers, they were destined for Al Burkan in London.
These pistols were carried to London by car. And this was one of the adventurous story. These weapons were in this car I drove to London.
So you drove the car?
Yeah, I drove the car.
On February the 28th, 1984, Nagler steered the Mercedes with its secret lethal cargo past the watchful eyes of East German border guards, then onto the coast for the ferry to Britain. His ticket shows he stayed in cabin 307 on C deck. This was just one of many such trips made by the Hein gang. The crossing was uneventful, but when Nagler reached the other side, there was a hitch. British customs were suspicious of the Mercedes.
At the border in England, by the custom, they have investigated this car very, very thoroughly, and they have removed the panels from the doors, the panels from the luggage room, and they investigated in the engine compartments, but they didn't find anything. But they have forgotten to get under. they forgot to look under the car. And so I drove this car directly to London. I drove directly to London Hotel Lancaster, where Satou was already waiting for me.
So you met Satou?
Yes, I met Satou, and I drove this car to a parking lot, and then went with Satou in his hotel room.
So the weapons definitely went from Berlin to Satou?
Definitely from Berlin to Satou.
And did he pay for them?
He paid to Hein.
He didn't pay the money to you?
He didn't pay the money to
me. But you know he got those weapons?
Right. Definitely.
And who else was there from Al Burkan? Was it just Satou?
Just Satou.
Just Satou.
Just Satou.
Satou was the main man, as far
Satou
as you were
concerned. Satou was the main man, and Satou was the only man I got in touch, and I met in Berlin, and I spoke to him in London.
And what sort of man was Satou?
He was a normal man, and as far as I could see, he was a real friend to Hein. Hein told me he can rely on him and he trusts him.
But as far as you're concerned, he was the man behind Al Burkan and he was the man who was behind these killings.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely right.
By the day of the demonstration, 6 weeks after Nagler brought the guns to London, the anti-Gaddafi Libyans believed they were ready to mount a coup in Libya. But how to take world opinion with them? They felt they needed an inflammatory incident which could be blamed on Gaddafi, even if it meant sacrificing their own supporters.
Ich meine, da waren vorher auch andere Varianten im Umlauf, dass da eine Handgranate explodieren soll, ein richtiges Blutbad. Ich meine, es wurde viel erzählt.
Another member of the German gang told us privately it was decided 2 months before the demonstration that a British police officer would be targeted, killed in such a way that the incident could be pinned on Gaddafi. In the Reagan White House, Al Burkan's supporters were growing impatient. Libya's upstart leader had long seemed the perfect opponent for the president's so-called war on terrorism. Gaddafi also had vast reserves of high-quality oil. For commercial and ideological reasons, the Americans were desperate to unseat him and started calling for preemptive strikes. But countries like Britain took a more pragmatic view.
There were many in the British Foreign Office whose eyes would simply glaze over
whenever we would come and brief them on the alleged Libyan terrorist threat. And certainly in the case of Gaddafi, the Europeans consistently wanted to do business with Libya. So why alienate this opportunity just because those crazy cowboys in Washington thought Gaddafi was promoting a little terrorism?
But as images of Yvonne Fletcher's murder were beamed around the world, attitudes changed. It was to be a turning point, triggering international sanctions and isolation for Gaddafi. The only mystery, why had Gaddafi done it when his opponents were the only ones to benefit? In Berlin, Hilmar Hein was preparing for the takeover of Libya. The leaders of al-Burkan had promised him lucrative contracts to rebuild the country's capital, as well as valuable import concessions. On the day of Yvonne Fletcher's murder, Manfred Meyer was in Berlin too. He went round to see his boss, Hilmar Hein.
Es hieß er bloß, ein Polizist in einem Haus oder so. Er hatte erst mal gejubelt, hat eigentlich immer gejubelt. Ja. Er war auch euphorisch, weil er sagte, Mannes Sachen packen, nächste Woche sind wir unten in Libyen. Ja.
Und Sie sind der Meinung, dass die Mordwaffe aus hier, aus Berlin geliefert worden ist?
Damals, wir haben es offen darüber gesprochen, dass es unsere Waffe war und ja, das ist unser Ding. So haben wir gesprochen damals. Ja, wir haben da nicht so gesessen, haben da so drumherum, Mann, unsere Waffe und hat geklappt, gut.
Das ist sehr wichtig, was Sie sagen. Ja. Sie können das mit Sicherheit sagen.
Das kann ich mit Sicherheit sagen, ja.
The world was outraged by the shooting. As planned, Colonel Gaddafi was blamed. But the weapons the Hein gang had smuggled into London were still there, and 4 months later, they were to be used again. Bickenhall Mansions, just off Baker Street. A Libyan businessman was lured to a flat here, where he was shot in the back of the head. Ali El-Jahour's body was left in the bath, along with a Walter PPK handgun. The police suspected that the flat had been rented by Rajab Zatut of al-Burkan. They traced the gun, identification number 176979, back to Berlin and the Hein gang.
Es gab es eindeutige Belege dafür, dass zum Beispiel eine Waffe ihren Weg direkt von Berlin nach London nahm und auch in London nachher Verwendung fand bei einer Straftat, nämlich bei der Tötung eines Libyers.
Und das können Sie feststellen?
Das ließ sich deswegen feststellen, weil der Waffenlieferant ein Waffenliebhaber war, der seine Waffe sehr gut identifizieren konnte und auch in der Lage war, die Waffennummer zu benennen. Und das fand sich dann bestätigt durch den Fund in London bei der Tat zum Nachteil des Giauer, glaube ich, Sir Giauer.
Meyer became the key prosecution witness in a case which heard of al-Burkan's activities all over Europe. He told the German police, not only did he know about El-Jahour's murder weapon, he also knew about the gun which killed Yvonne Fletcher.
Und Sie sind jetzt der Meinung, dass die Polizistin Yvonne Fletcher von einer dieser Waffen erschossen worden war?
Nenne ich jetzt der Meinung? Der Meinung war ich schon immer. Also das hatte ich auch beim BKA gesagt oder beim BND, wo ich ein halbes Jahr zur Vernehmung war. Ja, oder das hatte ich von Anfang an.
But while Manfred Meyer was telling his secrets, other shadowy figures were covering up. They knew that were light to be cast on their role in this tragedy, it would destroy the already tarnished reputations of the British and American intelligence agencies, probably forever. From the start, mystery surrounded the murder of Ali El-Jahour, the Libyan businessman killed 4 months after Yvonne Fletcher. The inquest was handled by the same team who investigated her death, coroner Paul Knapman and pathologist Ian West. Unusually, part of the key evidence was heard in private.
And I can only believe that that had to do with Mr. Jahour's activities. He was quite adamant in protesting his innocence because he felt that he'd been assisting the British authorities for some time in Libya. He had been providing them with what he considered to be intelligence.
So he'd been working for British intelligence, he said?
So he said. That's correct.
Did you find that plausible?
I think that in the circumstances it probably was quite plausible, yes.
At the time of his death, he was charged with involvement in these bomb attacks on anti-Gaddafi dissidents. On the face of it, this would seem to make him a Gaddafi supporter, but our investigations reveal that El-Jahour was actually a member of al-Burkan, the anti-Gaddafi terrorist group.
Who was officially blamed for these bombs?
The pro-Libyan government, the Gaddafi faction, was blamed for the bombings.
But in hindsight, you suspect it may have been otherwise, do you?
I think it could well have been otherwise, yes.
Remarkably, given the serious charges, conspiracy to cause explosions, El Jahor was given bail. But from the moment he was released, he told his lawyer he thought he was a dead man.
He felt that whatever happened, that he was really of no longer of any use to any of the people for whom he'd previously been working, whether it was the pro-Gaddafi faction, the anti-Gaddafi faction, or any other agencies he may have been working for. His useful life had come to a grinding halt, effectively.
Since the murders of Yvonne Fletcher and Ali El Jahour, MI5 and MI6 have moved to expensively furnished new buildings. Theirs is a daily life of secret agendas, a wilderness of mirrors where little is as it seems. In this world where no one is ever held publicly accountable, it's easy for intelligence officers to lose any sense of morality. Winning is all that matters, and the human cost does not come into the equation. Dispatches have spoken to intelligence officers on both sides of the Atlantic who tell us that MI5 knew the day before Yvonne Fletcher's death that shooting was on the cards.
Members of the intelligence community believe that the security service did receive information from a reliable source and almost certainly from another intelligence agency.
So let's be clear about this. We're talking about MI5 here. We're talking about another intelligence agency. Who is this?
But almost certainly it was an American agency, whether it was the CIA or one of the other organizations, we don't know, but almost certainly another agency, possibly American, provided information to the security service to the effect that firearms were likely to be used in an incident involving the Libyan People's Bureau.
We've confirmed that the British and American security services were in regular contact with informants inside the embassy. Also at this time, they could easily decode telecommunications to and from the building. The day before the demonstration, the embassy cabled Libya with three options: do nothing, seize some of the dissidents, or shoot them. This crucial information, which would have saved Yvonne Fletcher's life, was intercepted, but it only got as far as British intelligence. It never reached those in the firing line. Selected journalists were told in unofficial briefings at the time that as messages flew between London and Libya, the crucial intercept got lost somehow in the bureaucratic maze. A seductive theory, but dismissed by insiders.
I think it's unbelievable that an intercept of such importance dealing with a prime target would have been put aside casually or overlooked. The intelligence services, despite the way that sometimes they're projected, are very efficient organizations. And an electronic intercept would have passed through a number of different bodies within a very short period of that message being received.
If there is a need to do something before morning, then it will be done. Some of the people I worked with were on bleeps. They'd be woken up, rung up, cars would be sent to fetch them in, brought in, emergency meetings would be had. All could happen in the middle of the night if it was necessary. Even if you had doubts, then you would wake somebody more senior up so they would carry the can, not you.
So it's inconceivable that you could have a succession of cock-ups in a short period of time that would mean a key piece of information would be totally overlooked. I just don't accept that.
Unsere Nachrichten erschaffen haben. Und da ich begriffen, aha, jetzt geht's los.
Is this in im Ernst?
Jetzt ist es war ernst. Es gab für mich ja kein Zurück mehr. Ja. Und dann wurde auch gesprochen, dann hat er mich auch, um mich zu beruhigen und mich auf Linie zu halten, dann die Version gebracht, dass er eben mit den Leuten davon reden. Ich sag mal, die Namen waren mir damals nicht sehr geläufig, Poindexter Nord war für mich kein Begriff.
Aber Hein hat gesagt, keine Panik, wir sind vom Amerikanen geschützt.
Das waren die Worte von Hein, ja.
But the German mercenaries quickly learned the harsh realities of life with the intelligence services. They were simply expendable. Once in custody, Meyer's reaction was to talk, providing endless details of Al-Burkan's activities, including the killings in London of Ali El-Jahour and Yvonne Fletcher. three British police officers flew to Berlin to interrogate the Hein gang.
What did they want to know?
Well, just the way the weapons brought I have brought to London, no? And I have told them the truth, no? That they were brought by car, no? And
were they very interested?
Yes, they were very interested, no? To know how, no?
Also diese Polizisten aus Scotland Yard, Sie haben auch über den Tod von Yvonne Fletcher gesprochen?
Das war alles ein bisschen, ich meine, ich habe mich mit denen einmal unterhalten, das war an der Kaltstraße, ja. Aber eigentlich nicht, das war fünf Minuten und das war's, ja.
But the police weren't the only people to call on the Berlin public prosecutor. Shortly after the Scotland Yard officers returned to London, he got another visitor from Britain.
Also ein Vertreter der Geheimdienste, könnte man zumuten.
Ich kenne mich in den britischen Strukturen nicht so gut aus, könnte sein.
Das haben Sie zurzeit gedacht, oder?
Ich persönlich habe es vermutet.
In the end, the British authorities did not pursue the German angle. The German police took a different view and charged Meyer, Nagler and Hein with various crimes in support of Al-Burkan. All three went to prison. The German authorities wanted to question the Libyan who pulled the strings, Rajib Zatout, now living in the USA. But they too had a lesson to learn. Some people, called assets in the intelligence world, are just too valuable.
Ich hätte ihn gerne selbst befragt, aber er war dann unseren Zugriff entzogen, letztlich in die USA, wohl ausgewichen.
Man spekuliert, dass Herr Zatout von den Amerikanern geschützt wurde. Kann das sein?
Weiß ich nicht.
Aber er ist nicht nach Deutschland gekommen.
Ich weiß nur, er ist nicht nach Deutschland gekommen. Ich weiß nur, dass ich keine Antwort auf mein Rechtshilfeersuchen bekommen habe.
And Rajib Zatout was not the only member of the Al-Burkan terrorist group to be supported by the Western intelligence agencies. Our investigations have discovered that certain diplomats inside the London embassy were also secret Al-Burkan members, in close contact with their British and American minders. After Gaddafi's fall, they would have become members of a new Libyan government, friendly to the West and to Western oil interests.
Mitglieder von Al-Burkan waren unerkannt im libyschen Volksbüro in London und die sollten mit dieser Aktion raus, aber so, dass sie in Tripolis nicht aufsehen oder Misstrauen erregen, ja, dann wäre der Putsch gekommen, wenn das so geklappt hätte und dann hätten die da drüben quasi dann die Schlüsselpositionen besetzt oder hatten dann wohl scheinbar ihre anderen Verschwörer auch wieder, die gibt es ja überall oder, ja.
Und wann sollte der Putsch geschehen?
Das sollte eigentlich unmittelbar danach passieren, ja?
There was one potential hiccup. The public expectation was that the SAS would storm the building and kill the occupants, just like the Iranian embassy siege 4 years earlier. One of the SAS soldiers called to the square was Steve Devereaux.
My main entry point was up here, the top right hand window. You just about see it above the parapet. That was the first entry point. I would have run across the roof, placed the explosive charge on the particular window, blown the window, and then we would have assaulted through the window, four of us. Somebody throwing flashbangs, creating noise and havoc, taking out any targets that were in there. Well, we would have had MP5s, two of us would have had shotguns, sawn-off shotguns, and pistols.
Would you have expected that some of the Libyans would have had to be killed in this process?
If they were armed, yes.
Were you disappointed when you stood there?
Absolutely right, yes. We'd psyched ourselves up for almost 10 days, 2 weeks. And to be told that we weren't going to storm it, you know, that, it really wasn't, it pissed a lot of people off.
There's no doubt in your mind that you would have been able to successfully storm that embassy in the way that the Iranian embassy was stormed?
No problem. Absolutely no problem at all. And we would have done a bloody good job as well.
Instead, the diplomats were sent home. In public, Gaddafi gave them a hero's welcome, but in private, he was fighting for survival. 10 days after their return, he faced a major coup in which members of Al-Burkan took part. the French Secret Service and the CIA passed on satellite photographs and communications intercepts, but the rebellion failed after a street battle with the Libyan army. Ultimately, though, the killing of Yvonne Fletcher still served its purpose. 2 years later, American bombers flew from Britain to attack Libya. Other European states refused to let the bombers fly over their territory, and Margaret Thatcher was also reluctant to get involved. But she was swayed by just two words, Yvonne Fletcher.
It was certainly a key factor leading to the British government decision to provide support to the raid on Tripoli. Without British support, the raid probably would not have taken place at all. Without British support, you would have had really only a pinprick in terms of a strike against Libya, because you would not have been able to conduct an effective raid.
The intelligence agencies had finally got what they wanted, the chance to assassinate Gaddafi. Despite targeting his compound, they missed. But the Libyans say 160 civilians were killed in the raid.
A senior figure in the Reagan administration told me privately that the death of Yvonne Fletcher was the best thing that could have happened. What do you think he meant by that?
Well, the essence of the political dimension was that it changed the attitude of the British government toward Gaddafi. And it affected many Europeans as well, who suddenly saw that in their midst were diplomatic missions that indeed were housing thugs who were armed with explosives and assault weapons, who undoubtedly were carrying out the types of activities that they did not want to believe these individuals were capable of.
But that's a pretty cynical attitude to express, isn't it?
It's very cynical. Unfortunately, I think it's very realistic.
Presumably, at the time, you went along with the official line that we had to let the Libyans go because otherwise it would risk the lives of all the British expats who were living in Libya.
That seemed right and decent at the time. And obviously, being a serving soldier then, yes, we saw that. But I always sort of get myself reminded by what Thatcher used to say, and that was we never give in to terrorists. And on this particular day, we did.
And of course, there were still plenty of expats living in Tripoli when it was bombed 2 years later.
Absolutely right, yes.
As a former SAS soldier, what does this tell you about the way the country works?
Well, it works in strange ways, doesn't it? I mean, the security and intelligence agencies are trying to work to a common cause, but in this particular instance, I don't think they work.
The last government said it's hurtful, we shouldn't reopen these wounds. I mean, what would you say to that?
Well, it is hurtful, but until the whole situation is cleared up, it's not only hurtful to us, but it's hurtful to all the policemen and that who were there at the time, them not knowing what really happened.
So you think it's right for
and
people
I think,
keep looking into this?
I think it is until they've found out the truth of the situation.
What would you say to Mr. Blair and his new government?
I would say, do you think your ministers could look into the case of Yvonne's death and try to find out the real truth, what happened?
Because that's anyway your mind can be put at rest.
Yes, definitely.